In this video, I'm going to show you the process of rendering an entire house. I just finished working on these 6 images and I thought it would be interesting to make a video about it and share a couple of valuable things. This project is from my friends at Olmo Arquitetos. I'll leave their info in the video description in case you want to check this project in full. It was entirely modeled in ArchiCAD and this is the file I got. I then exported to SketchUp, just a simple and default export. I only made sure to turn off the vegetation layer. I used V-Ray for SketchUp as the render engine and then worked a bit in Photoshop to do some post-production. The goal of this video is not to be a specific tutorial on a single program, but more to share the workflow I use to tackle a challenge like this. So if you use another 3D software or render engine, don't worry, there's still a lot of value you can take out of this video. Now, every commission type of work I do starts off by understanding the design from inside out and sitting down with the architects to talk about everything that should be visualized in the image. And this is where the sponsor of today's video comes in, Milanote. Milanote is a tool for organizing creative projects. It's this collaborative digital whiteboard that helps you visualize ideas, a place where you can unload all of your creative thinking. I use Milanote to organize my ideas, checklists, and notes, and also when I've got a job like this where I need to make sure all of the vital information is located in a single place. Reference images, inspirations, specific notes, photos, color palettes, materials, multiple links, and more. As I mentioned, it's collaborative, so this board was done by multiple people, ensuring that I had everything on hand before getting started, and this avoids any back and forth of test renders or redos. Now, any new board you create can start with a template, which is kind of cool to get things moving, or it can be an empty canvas to fit your specific needs. Milanote has a tools to enhance this visual process, from drawing tools to notes, checklists, and more. I've been using Milanote for a while and I truly believe it can add a lot of value to you as well. Click the link in the video description to get started for free and start planning your next creative project. Thanks Milanote for sponsoring this video. Okay, so with all of the information ready, it was time to get down to business. Quick note here, the entire process took more or less 20 hours from extra modeling to render settings and post-production, not to mention the actual render time. Now, this is an estimate so that you have it in mind, but it changes from work to work. As I mentioned, I'm gonna break down the most important steps. Even though I've got it all recorded here, it'll be impossible for me to cover it all in a single video. Don't forget that timestamps are available down below. 99% of the time in a visualization workflow, I start off by defining the scenes I'm gonna work with. This allows me to see what will be in frame or not, and then I can prioritize editing. However, when it comes to rendering an entire project from multiple angles and all, you almost certainly will end up editing the entire model. Still, defining scenes is crucial. It's at this stage that I also set the viewing angle or camera lens. I've talked about this in other videos, which I'll link up here or here in the video description, but it's usually around 24 to 35 millimeters. At least it's what I've found out to output the most natural results, you know, without any spatial distortions. Also here that I start playing with image proportions. I knew I wanted to go for 1:1 aspect ratio on all of the images except the first one. Then the next step for me is usually the overall lighting. It is important to have a simple render setup to start testing other stuff. Working with HDRI results in a more realistic lighting, so I usually turn off the default sun, add a dome light, and test out different HDRI maps. I either use the ones in V-Ray Cosmos or the free ones over HDRI Haven. Now, at this point, it will look bad, but you gotta trust the process. Make sure to work with the override materials at the beginning, start an interactive render, and get to the settings. Lighting is something that will undoubtedly change by scene, so set up something temporary and then move on to something else. Now, if you're into architectural visualization and representation, don't forget to subscribe to Upstairs to not miss any new videos. Now, what I've found out to work the best is to start with the category and work until almost done. For example, I'm starting here with the trees, and this took a while. I'm trying to match the existing trees on site, a taller row back there, and a short one along the site perimeter. Also, the tree species were kind of hard to get right. I was looking for some Atlantic forest type of vegetation, and I got as close as I thought it was. Usually, render engine libraries provide only North American and European species, which is tough. Listen, I'm using individual trees here because I want to get a specific look. But if that wasn't the case, I would go for the scatter tool, which would make things a lot lighter and faster to work with. I'll talk about it when I'm doing the grass. Oh, and something important to point out here is that even though I had an insane amount of trees, as you can see, I was trying to align them to fill the horizon. Still, it wasn't enough and I was seeing some blank spots, so then I got tired and simply added an image back here to fill it up. Now, other bushes and smaller plants are even harder to figure out the final shape. V-Ray uses proxies so that it makes everything lighter, but then only when rendered you can see the final form. I mean, you can change the visibility, the level of detail, but once you have a lot of objects, it's just too heavy to do this. So I like to work with a low quality interactive render to help me place plants accordingly. I noticed that the actual proxies are way smaller than the rendered plants, so take that into account. By the way, this pool was designed to use natural filtering plants. Now, whatever render engine I'm using, either Lumion, V-Ray, Twinmotion, or others, I always try to rely as much as possible on the existing library of objects. This, of course, for the less important items, the ones that won't impact that much the final identity of the render. Otherwise, your image can feel very generic. I do have a small personal library of 3D objects that I've gathered throughout the years, but I also rely a lot on the 3D warehouse from SketchUp. Same goes for materials on the scene. I use as much of the ready-to-use library for the unimportant materials, and then I like to use Polygon for the most important ones. I know Polygon is not cheap if you're a student or do visualization only as a small part of your daily architect's task, and there are other websites out there that have the same type of product, a lot of free ones as well, but you will need to do a lot of digging. Now, if you're interested, we do have our own PBR texture pack on the Upstairs store. I'll leave a link in the video description. Also, something that I've been experimenting with is using the round corner plugin to break up some of the more important volumes. You know that nothing in the real world has actual 90 degree sharp corners like this, right? And then if we're talking about casting placed concrete, well, then the edges are way rougher. There are many limitations here in SketchUp, but just by chamfering a bit, we're making things more real. This is just a minor step that honestly, up until this round of images, I never actually used it. But you know, I'm always looking to learn something new and test different techniques. Now, what I have been doing for some time now is playing with flat terrains. For example, this is indeed supposed to be a leveled gravel surface, but there should be at least a slight deformation to the surface. So divide the area into multiple squares and use the sandbox tool to make it uneven. Now, as general tweaks go, that's almost it. I did the vegetation, materials, basic lighting, edges, and terrain. Then there's the grass left. I'm using the scatter tool, as I mentioned. I grabbed a couple of the grass objects from V-Ray Cosmos, selected them all, and added them to a new scatter object. Play with the randomized setting until you get the result you like, and remember to use the interactive render in a low quality to visualize it. And when the grass surface is too large, like this one, I prefer not to show the previews. It lags way too much. If I can be honest, I've never actually used Fur to create grass, and if you have and prefer this method, please let me know in the comments below. I've only done grass through post-production and using the scatter. Alright, that's pretty much it regarding rendering and modeling. Now it comes down to the individual scenes. I like to play with framing, adding things to the foreground helps to feel like you're actually in that spot. It adds extra layers of interest to the image. As I mentioned, each particular scene had slight changes from lighting to exposure and all, but all of them were rendered in medium, not high because it was taking too long. All of them were at least 3000 pixels tall, denoiser turned on, also played a bit with volumetric environment, and a very subtle ambient occlusion. With the base renders on hand, and obviously all of the other important render elements to help me with the post-production, it was Photoshop time. Now let me quickly run by each image and what I worked on in Photoshop, and I'll be sure to link my Behance in the video description in case you want to see the images in full. So for the first one, I had to re-render the water because I didn't get it right on the first pass. Then it was mostly overall exposure corrections, changing the sky as well, which I always do. And then although the concrete needed to feel very rough as it is right now, and this was one of the requirements from the guys at Olmo, it was too contrasty. So I brought the blacks and whites closer together on a levels adjustment. This was quite easy since I had a material render element on hand. Then I added people with proper color and levels adjustment, and very important, shadow and reflections. Okay, the second image is the most different image of them all. I wanted to do something moodier to show the metal fire pit. The fire took multiple layers and I did it all here in Photoshop. Now, I could have done the reddish slash orange light source back in V-Ray to help me here, but I decided to go all in post. Adding proper highlights to the surroundings is vital, both to the existing base render, but also to people. Also, if you're doing some sort of fire, blur it a bit, it helps to sell the effect. Add little sparks, a bit of smoke, yeah, it makes it perfect. Oh, on this image, I had to darken the whole foreground here in Photoshop. I used the render elements to help me better select stuff. I wanted to darken the plants more than the grass. Now for the third image, it was quite quick. Basic overall corrections. The most intense work was over the person I added. A bit of color adjustment and extra care on the shadow. I like to do the shadows in multiple layers. For example, one for the long shadow. And I usually use the blend mode soft light. It blends in with the image color, adding a tint to the shadow. Then another layer for the stronger touch shadow. This one is usually in normal blend mode. Now, if you want to learn in full how a non-destructive post-production workflow works, we've got a full course here at Upstairs that teach you that step by step, detailed lessons. Link in the video description as well. Now, the fourth image was a front scene. It showed a lot more of the interior, so the most intense work was over the interior lighting. Here, using a library of the decoration objects is key to producing an interesting interior without spending too much time on it. Oh, and people cutouts are meant to add to the image story. Yeah, give a sense of scale to the whole thing, I know, but also show more of the space uses. When there's a situation like this, take extra time in finding the best cutouts you can for your image. The pool scene had also minor tweaks, mostly bringing up the exposure. It was too dark. I then added a bit of glare to where the light was coming in. Now, instead of adding caustics to the render back in V-Ray, which would turn out into a very realistic water, but also it would increase render time so much, I decided to add it here in Photoshop. I know it doesn't look perfect, but it does its job. It could even be here and you would already understand that this is a pool. Oh, and I added a bit of tiny tint to the water. I wasn't able to do it properly in V-Ray. As soon as I gave it a slight color, the water just turned black. You know, it's one of those issues when you cannot figure out what's wrong, but then I just prefer to handle it in Photoshop and not spend time messing with V-Ray settings. It's just quicker and easier here in Photoshop. One important tip when adding people behind glass is to make sure you have a reflection channel render with your base render. So then you can edit over the person, change the blend mode to screen, and you precisely inserted someone behind glass. Now, lastly, the interior bedroom image. Most of the work in these type of images are done back in the rendering software, so here it was more a matter of fixing small stuff, adding people and all. I also replaced the gravel, which I had to re-render, but other than that, it was the easiest image of them all. And that concludes the six images. Don't forget to like this video if you learned something new. I've got a lot of other videos here on the channel that talks about rendering in post-production. Here's a playlist if you want to continue learning about it. Lots of steps were skipped that I've already covered in these videos, but in any case, feel free to drop your questions in the comments below.